So we were discussing transmitter circuits, and we saw that in ideal conditions, when you have ideal switches and no other loss, the current consumed in the transmitter is 1/4 when you use a voltage mode transmitter with a differential termination, okay, compared to a current mode transmitter with any kind of termination. And the current is half compared to a voltage mode transmitter with a common mode type of termination, okay. Common mode, I mean, meaning individual resistors are from each of the transmission lines to ground. If you do that, you will end up consuming twice the power. So, since power is at a premium, it makes sense to use a purely differential termination and a voltage mode transmitter. But the voltage mode transmitter is not as clean as a current mode transmitter in some respects, in terms of mainly control of the output resistance and so on, okay. But there are ways around it, because the advantage is so much, there are people have come up with different kinds of ways. First of all voltage mode transmitters look like this, that first of all you have the main supply VDD, and from there you need to have some regulator, I will call it LDO. So, this is basically a voltage regulator that gives you the voltage to be transmitted, that is 2 VP, okay. And there are two switches, there is a high side switch and a low side switch, okay. And all our implementations are differential, that means there will be two such units, okay. They should be like this, and for the other arm, other differential arm, you will have the complementary control signals, okay. So, this is a fully differential voltage mode transmitter. And the way this is implemented is, this switch plus the resistance that you want to implement, that the termination resistance that you want to have, that is realized using a MOS transistor, okay. Now, there are a couple of different options. For the low side switch, the common sense dictates that it should be an NMOS transistor. For the high side switch, if 2 VP is large, you cannot use an NMOS transistor, you would not be able to switch that voltage, okay. Whereas, if 2 VP is small, you could use an NMOS switch for the high side as well, okay. But if the swing is large, you have to use a PMOS switch for the higher side. And also there are two things, one is to control 2 VP, which is done by that regulator, you just decide whatever swing you want and then you put it there. And then there is the matter of controlling the output resistance. For that, essentially you have to control the on resistance of the switch, and to do that you have to, because the transistor's characteristics change substantially with process and temperature, you have to either change the gate source voltage, okay, to get the right resistance, or change the size of the MOSFET. Change the size of the MOSFET means that you have an array of MOS transistors which can be switched in and out, and you select an appropriate number of them, okay, to drive. So, either one is used. Essentially what is done is, there is a replica feedback loop that sets the resistance of the switch in the on state, okay. And I am assuming you know what these replica biasing type of schemes are. Essentially you have another switch that is on, this is a replica, and then you have to pass some current, and for it to be a good replica, the current that you have to pass should be such that the voltage generated here is the same as what is generated in the actual use scenario, right. That is when it is a good replica, because if you are switching 100 millivolts and then in the replica you have 10 millivolts, it is not actually a good replica. So, you should have the same, you should try to, yeah, replica means, I mean, everything should be replicated ideally. And you make sure that this voltage is around that range, and you lock it to a reference, okay? And based on this comparison, you change the resistance. When I say change the resistance, either change VGS or change W by L, okay? So, to change W by L, essentially what you will have is this switch split into multiple units, and then you have to drive the correct number of them, okay? So, in the actual transmitter, you may have, let us say, 16 parallel units, or maybe also you do not need to control from 0 to some value perhaps. That is, many times you want to control it from, let us say, some value to some other value. So, you have some unit that is always used, and then a number of subunits which can be turned on. So, you provide drive to only a certain number of those subunits, so that the effective resistance becomes whatever you want. Is this clear? Once you understand the logic, you will be able to sit and implement the circuit, but the most important thing is to understand the logic behind the whole thing. Alternatively, you can control the VGS, in which case whatever gate is driving this, right? This will not be supplied from VDD, but with some other VG drive, and this VG drive is what you obtain from replica biasing, okay? So, this way also you can control the resistance. This is okay? So, you do have first of all additional circuits and so on. So, that is why you will not get 1/4 of the current savings, but you may get half, I mean sorry, you will not get 75% current savings, but you may get 50%, which is still good, okay? Any questions about this, the voltage mode transmitter? Now, if you want equalization, what you really do is, you do not, you cannot put things in series, that is part is not in voltage mode. Okay, that is, you do not put the output voltage of the main tap and the output voltage of the post cursor tap in series, that you cannot do. Okay, you actually add things in parallel, you still add in currents, but you just have an appropriate number of units, so that the contribution of it is basically like this. Equalization taps, the equivalent picture is this. So, let us say this is the cursor, it will have some resistance R naught. And then let us say this is the post cursor voltage, and it will have some resistance R 1. You have to first of all make sure that this R 0 parallel R 1 is the right termination, okay. On top of it, this voltage you can find out now from a linear combination of post cursor and post cursor. So, that gives you the weights, okay. Now, you design these things for the same voltage typically. Right? I mean, you design the same voltage transmitter for this and that. So, the open circuit voltage of the cursor and post cursor taps will be the same, and R 0 and R 1 will be different. So, that gives you the tap ratio, right? Because if R 1 is large and R 0 is small, you know that the cursor tap will have a lot of weight and the post cursor tap will have a very small weight, and the other way around. Is this okay? So, essentially it means that first of all, typically you make everything as a number of parallel units of small devices, okay. So, you will use a large number of parallel units for the cursor and a small number of parallel units for the post cursor, if the post cursor tap weight is small compared to the main cursor tap. As the post cursor tap weight increases compared to the main cursor tap, the number of units used in the post cursor increases relative to the number of units in the cursor. Is this okay? You can do it. I mean, typically in the transmitter, you do not have too many taps. In fact, this voltage mode transmitter may be a little cumbersome to have too many taps with, but you can do that. The current mode transmitter, it is more straightforward, okay. You can have a precursor tap in the transmitter, because the DFE, which is extremely effective, cannot do anything about the precursor, yeah. You have to change the, yeah, there has to be some tap control, tap weight control, yeah. No, 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 you have to, okay. So, let's say I have it like this. Okay, so this is R naught times n and this is a voltage transmitter which can transmit from 0 to 1. What input you give to this, the control is up to you, okay. And then I have n of these in parallel. If I have n of these in parallel, what is the looking in resistance? R naught, right? It will just be this parallel stuff. Now, how do you change the tap weight? You should still keep n of them, but the number you choose for post and the cursor and the post, the other tap should change, okay. So, let us say you have like the cursor tap has n minus 1 and the post cursor tap, let us look at like basically a two tap equalizer, just has 1. Then this is like having a transmitter with an impulse response. If I normalize the cursor to 1, this will be 1 and this will be 1 by n minus 1, okay. But if I normalize the cursor to, let us say, some absolute value, so this will be n minus 1 by n and this will be 1 by n, okay. If you want to increase equalization, what you can do is, for instance, this could be n minus 2 and this is 2. What happens then? In an absolute sense, this has become n minus 2 by n and this is 2 by n. Now, this problem we have encountered before, right? As you increase the amount of equalization, the cursor tap itself has to reduce, okay. This is a problem with the transmit equalization. So, this is what is going to happen, okay. But you see that now the termination resistance is not changing, only the amount of equalization is changing. So, this, by the way, this part about things being in parallel and then you assign a number of units to the cursor or post cursor, this is true for either current mode or voltage mode transmitter, assuming you are limited to a certain swing, okay. In the current mode transmitter also you could do this, you can just simply split the whatever differential pair you have into a large number of small differential pairs. And the most flexible kind of transmitter would be, you take a certain number of them, assign them to cursor, certain number of them, assign them to post cursor, certain number of them, assign them to precursor. The taps do not even have to be contiguous, you can have 1 plus z to the minus 3, I mean if your equalization really needs that, okay, that is possible. But you understand, I mean it is possible to change it without changing the termination resistance, okay. Let's say vaguely as equalization increases. Now, this is the problem with the transmit equalizer. It is actually quite easy to implement nicely, the FIR semi-digital technique, because you are after all operating with binary inputs. But the problem is, that if you try to implement a lot of equalization meaning the absolute sum of the non-cursor taps is large, then your cursor tap itself becomes small. You will end up transmitting smaller and smaller signals, okay. Now, that is also a problem, because if you have perfect equalization, but if your signal amplitude is very small, you will still make a lot of bit errors. Any questions about the voltage mode transmitter? So, we have looked at the transistor level circuits very briefly. The circuits we have looked at are, already at the system level, we have talked about many things, right? The CDR at the flip flop level, the DFE at the flip flop level and so on. Whereas, at the transistor level, we have not seen too many circuits except this transmitter circuits and the VCO, okay. Now, the other things that are left are, first of all, in the receiver, typically the receiver looks like this, there can be a continuous time linear equalizer if necessary. This actually we have seen at the transistor level, and there can be multiple amplifier stages, possibly with variable gain also. Okay, and after that come the rest of the stuff, that is decision feedback equalization, clock and data recovery, decision and all those things. Okay, this one, I mean, there isn't like too much choice in the receiver. Actually, a good circuit to use for most of these things is just a differential pair. So, for the continuous time linear equalizer, most frequently used stuff is this very simple single zero structure, where this capacitance sets the zero value. And for these amplifiers, again, there isn't too much choice here. Okay. Again, one of the things is if you want decision feedback equalization, all these circuits should be such that with the input swing they operate linearly. If you don't have equalization, they can go into nonlinear stuff. They can kind of saturate and then you just clock the saturated values. But if you need like further decision feedback equalization, you need to have linear operation . Now this is quite simple. The main problem is at high speeds, I mean, you will have these parasitic capacitors everywhere, which will limit the bandwidth. Okay. And to change the gain again, there are couple of possibilities. You change the bias current in a single differential pair. That is possible. I mean, you have to be a little careful. What happens is, as the current becomes smaller, it becomes less and less linear. Okay, because the amount of voltage across the differential pair at the input of the differential pair required to completely switch the current increases with the bias current, right? So if you have very small bias current, it can switch with a very small voltage. So that means that it is actually more and more nonlinear. That is, for a given swing, if you have very small bias current, it goes into nonlinear mode. So you have to make sure that that doesn't happen if you desire linear operation. But it's an easy way of changing the gain. If you change the bias current, you will change the GM and you will change the gain. Okay. Or again, you can change the size in the sense, as usual, what this means is you have multiple units operating in parallel and you turn on a certain number of them. Okay. In this case, you don't necessarily have this nonlinearity effect, because if you change I naught as well as the size of this, then the amount of voltage required to switch remains exactly the same, right. So, if you have a certain differential pair with a certain bias current and another one with half the width and half the bias current, you will have exactly the same type of characteristic, the linearity characteristic. So, it does not affect linearity. So, that is another possibility. Okay. Then what else is required in the receiver? One of the problems is, I mean, all these are high bandwidth circuits. So, that means that you will end up using, how do you choose the length of the transistors to be used in the differential pair? I mean, in a serial link, what would you choose? You would probably choose minimum length, because you want to get the highest bandwidth. That is, if you choose a longer device, what happens is, for the carrying the same amount of current or to generate the same amount of GM, you also have to make it wider. So, now the transistor is wider and longer. So, every parasitic is larger. Okay, the drain parasitics, which mainly contribute to this parasitic basically is the drain parasitics of this stage plus the gate parasitics of the following stage. If you have a longer and wider transistor, both of these will increase and your bandwidth will reduce. Okay. So, typically in serial links you do not have too much option. I mean, I am again assuming that you are kind of stretching the speed limit of the technology. So, you do not have much option but to operate with minimum length. Now, what is the consequence of using small transistors in an analog circuit? RDS becomes small, that is true. I mean, that means that the maximum DC gain you can get is small, but that is okay. I mean, you can't do much about it, because the DC gain is smaller. There is but if you try to increase the DC gain by increasing the length anyway, the bandwidth will reduce. So, at the high frequencies the gain will become smaller. So, DC gain you just have to deal with. Hopefully, you have still enough DC gain, that is all. What else? I mean, what other consequences are there to using small transistors?
Mismatch.
Yeah. So, the moment you use try to use small transistors, you will end up with higher random mismatch. So, what is the effect of random mismatch here? What does random mismatch do in a serial link listening receiver? You have a chain of amplifiers. One more noise? No. What's the, I mean, if you have a differential pair and you have random mismatch, what's the consequences? Offset. Okay. So that's a problem. So now you do have some gain, maybe like 20 dB gain or something before you make the decision. But then this offset also goes on accumulating. Okay. Now essentially that means that at the input of the decision slicer, this is supposed to go there. Let us say you have enough equalization, you open the eye, you did all the right stuff. Okay. Still your 0 level could be here because of offset. I mean, it is skewed to one side or the other. If you make a decision with this threshold, obviously you will have lots of bit error rates. So, you have to correct for the offset. Okay. How do you do that? Like, what are all the ways of getting rid of offset in an analog circuit? Yeah, how do you, I mean, in general, like you have DC, offset is DC, right? So, how do you get rid of that signal? One obvious thing is AC coupling. Okay. In fact, AC coupling can be used, or can it be used in a serial link? Is there any problem? Yeah, yeah. So, you are saying you inject an offset in some other way. Yeah, that is possible. Yeah. No, but I mean AC coupling, can we use it in a serial link, or is there a problem? Because it is broadband, it has to be big. So, basically the in general in a broadband, the spectrum looks like this, right, of a rectangular broadband rectangular data. So, the spectral density extends all the way to DC. So, if you use AC coupling transfer function will be something like that. You will cut off some of the energy. Okay. An easier way to see that is in the time domain. If you have purely random data, okay, with some probability, you will have long strings of ones or zeros. Okay, that is, there will be a long period of time where the input signal is not changing. Now, what happens if you put this to an AC coupling circuit? So, let us say the signal looks like this. In the middle there is a long string of ones. So, what will happen? What will the output look like if I pass it through a AC coupling? Is basically a high pass filter, right? Huh? Yeah, what happens is that it will follow this, okay, and then it may follow this, But if you hold this for a long time, eventually this will start drooping and eventually go to 0, okay, because with DC input this will give you a 0 output. Now this will happen for some length, I mean it depends on the cutoff frequency of the high pass filter. If the cutoff frequency of the high pass filter is lower, this will happen after a longer time, okay. But to make a lower cutoff frequency, you have to use a larger capacitor, okay. Now if you have purely random data, there is a certain non-zero probability of this being of any length, okay. You can have 50 ones, 100 ones, any number, but of course the probability becomes very, very small, okay. So you have to assume that the number of ones is not more than something and then design for it. That is, let us say I say that in this case I have written like 7 ones, let us assume that 7 is the maximum we will have. Then I have to design the cutoff frequency of the low pass filter such that in this time maybe it will droop, but maybe not by much. Maybe I will say that it has to droop only by like 5% or something. So based on that I can design the cutoff frequency of the high pass filter. Now there are also coding techniques, that is you by design your data pattern is such that you cannot have, this is known as run length, or the this is known as CID, consecutive identical digits. So the number of consecutive identical digits are equivalently the run length that can be limited to some value using coding, okay. So this is sometimes done, this is basically done specifically to permit. There are two things that happen with this very long run length, that is very large number of consecutive identical digits. One is of course you can't use AC coupling conveniently, you have to push the corner frequency to very low values. The other, of course, you know, the clock and data recovery circuit also will have a problem if you don't have a large number of bits without any transitions. So to help both of these, there are other coding techniques which I didn't deal with at all. So you basically limit the run length, okay. So you could say that you cannot have more than, I don't know, 5 consecutive identical ones or zeros, okay. Now any coding technique like that also increases the number of bits. That is, let's say first you allow for any pattern, okay. That is, you don't have any restrictions on the pattern. Then if you have n bits, you have 2 to the n possible values, okay. Now to convey the same information but with another bit pattern which has these restrictions, okay, you need a larger number of bits, because you are not allowing for all bit patterns, right. Because if I have n bits, then I have 2 to the n possible messages and one of them includes all n bits being 1, the other one includes all n bits being 0. Now if you eliminate those possibilities, to send the same 2 to the n messages, I should use more bits, okay, because I am saying that some bit combinations cannot exist. So this will actually increase the data rate, okay. So there are many such coding things, again we just don't have time to go into all of this. There is one thing known as 8B 10B coding. As the name suggests, for every 8 bits of the input which is assumed completely random, you will have 10 bits at the output. So this is actually increasing the data rate by 25%, which can also be a big concern. That is, your job was to design a 10 gigabits per second system, which is hard enough, now you have to go and design a 12.5 gigabits per second system. But the point is, I mean the run length will be limited, so your CDR and your receivers can work better, you could also use AC coupling in the chain and so on, okay. And there is another one which is more efficient, in that it is called 64-66 bit coding. Again, as the name suggests, for every 64 bits of the input, there is 66 bits in the output. This overhead is very small, it is like 1 by 30, about 3% or so. So this may be better, okay. Now whether you can use these codes or not, it is really not up to you, it depends on the standard, okay. So some standards specify the coding, some standards do not allow for it. If you had something completely proprietary where every you are designing everything, you can pick anything you want to make the whole system better. A combination of circuit design, coding, this type of techniques which make circuit design easier and so on. But this is not, I mean you will have some standards and you just have to follow that, okay. So if you are allowed AC coupling, it's fine, or you have to keep the AC coupling corner very small. Okay. So allowing AC coupling is also useful for other things. I mean, you could actually use between the transmitter and receiver, you could have AC coupling. This is actually a good thing, because then the common mode level at the transmitter and the common mode level at the receiver can be completely different. Otherwise, if you have DC coupling, then the receiver common mode will be the same as the transmitter common mode, and this can also give you additional challenges. Okay. Any questions about this? We started this discussion by saying typically you use minimum length devices for high speed, so which typically also means you will have large offsets. Okay. So this, one of the ways to fix this is to use AC coupling. Now this is easier if it is run length limited, otherwise you have to push the corner frequency to be very low. Okay. Now this AC coupling actually looks like a very simple circuit. What is there? Just a capacitor and a resistor. Okay. But the point is, even in the run length limited cases, this capacitor can be quite large, because after all, I mean, in 10 gigabits per second case, this is 10 gigahertz. This corner will be much lower than that, in the megahertz or something. Okay. So then what will be the value of capacitors you need? It may still be a couple of picofarads, which is quite large on an integrated circuit. Now, what is the problem with an AC coupling circuit? What is the problem with a capacitor on an IC? What problem do you foresee? Yeah, actually what happens is, the capacitors are made by, this is the substrate, and you can have a plate like this and another plate like that. You can have multiple plates sandwiched and so on, but the bottom line is you have the desired capacitance like this and an undesired capacitance to ground. Alternatively, you have basically thin wires, which are the alternate ones are connected together. So the capacitance will be between these plates, but also between either plate and ground. So you will have a capacitance from at least one of the plates to ground, maybe both, and these capacitances are smaller than the capacitance that you want, but maybe by 10% or so. Okay. So now, I mean, again, we are looking at a scenario where we are trying to push the speed as much as possible. All these little capacitors will basically reduce the bandwidth and make your job that much harder. Okay. So although the conceptually this is very simple, this can be a pain, I mean, even with relatively high corner, because the capacitor will be of the order of picofarads maybe. So that is a problem. Okay. So that straightforward implementation of AC coupling may or may not be suitable. Okay. If it is hundreds of femtofarads, probably it is easier, but if it is picofarads, maybe the amount of bandwidth reduction you get because of its own parasitic swell is higher. So what other technique can you think of to effectively do the same thing? If you allow, return to zero coding. Return to zero coding also can have this problem, right? I mean, return to zero coding makes many things easier, but I am not sure if this is one of them, because, yeah, okay, maybe you are saying that it will be like this and like that. So yeah, perhaps it is easier, but you do not use this anyway, because this doubles the bandwidth that you have to deal with, right? So effectively achieving the same thing is this. So let us say you have a chain of amplifiers, maybe let me show it properly. instead of directly using AC coupling caps, what you can do is you can sense the DC output here, okay, and then pass it through an integrator. So that means that basically first imagine that this has 0 input. So if there is a DC here, this output will go on rising, okay. So and you do this. So this you can work out, the transfer function will be exactly the same as that of a high pass filter, a first order high pass filter, okay. The point is you are not putting things in the signal part directly, you are not putting large capacitors. You do have to make this summation. Like he suggested, what you typically do is you have let us say this is also an amplifier, at the output of the amplifier you can correct the offset. So this is the amplifier and to this you can add another differential pair, okay, which whose input you control from this integrator. So basically what happens is in steady state this output will be 0. Basically for DC. So, this will supply enough voltage to cancel the offset of the whole thing. It is exactly like AC coupling, but you are not using large caps, okay, but you somehow have to implement a very small omega u in the feedback path. That may also be challenging, that may need a large cap, but at least you are not putting it in the signal path, okay. Now, another equivalent possibility is, which is also attractive these days and kind of in the spirit of whatever we do these days, this whole thing, this integrator and adding stuff, it can be done with digital. I mean the adding stuff is of course analog offset, but essentially what you will be implementing is you have a DAC here and you have a digital accumulator. You sample the DC offset here and you go on accumulating. It is the same as integrating DC, and then the output of that you can put to a DAC so that it cancels the offset, okay. So this kind of thing you can do, and the advantage of the digital stuff is, for instance, once you do this you can stop the accumulation. Once you stop the accumulation, the forward frequency response does not have a low frequency cutoff anymore, right. It is like just adding, I mean I somehow magically found out the offset voltage here and then I cancelled it. So, but of course you have to keep doing this periodically because these offsets also can change with temperature and so on, but once in a while if you do it, it is okay, okay. So this can be done. So offset cancellation can also be an important requirement in the serial link receiver, because you do have gain, you use small devices, and because of that there is a problem, okay. Any questions? Low? Yeah. You have to have a, you have to have an ADC, yeah, to sense the offset. But again, I am just giving you the flavor of the solution. Basically, what you do is you sense the DC offset. That part you have to do accurately, like in any negative feedback, sensing is the most important thing. If you screw up the sensing, then all other controls you make will change the output to the erroneous value, right, if you make an error in sensing. But if you sense it accurately, after that there are many ways. Let us say you have a low speed A to D which gives you the digital value, and then you can set this offset correction, or you can implement the loop in analog way also. Basically, essentially if you evaluate the transfer function of this, you will again get a, you will get a 0 DC and there will be some corner frequency. So, that you have to choose based on the run length that you expect. Okay. Essentially, this corner frequency here, the effective corner frequency, whether you implement it in analog or digital, it should be low enough that, let us say you expect up to 15 consecutive identical digits, during that 15 there should be no droop. That is, during that 15 this loop should not act at all, basically that is the point, right? Because if you have a large number of ones and this thinks that is a DC and then starts correcting it, you will kill your signal. So, that should not happen. So, roughly, I mean, I will say, I mean, one criteria you could use is that from the full amplitude, it will droop a little bit, but let us say it droops by only, you constrain it to about 5%, then maybe that is good enough because that would not reduce the amplitude too much, okay. But whatever it is, if your run length is not limited, you cannot do this at all, because I mean, if you say that I will have infinite number of ones, I mean, no kind of AC coupling can take care of it. But the advantage of the digital stuff is, for instance, I mean, it is always possible with digital stuff, these things are nice that initially you choose a high cutoff frequency. So, that means that actually this is not good for receiving long run lengths, but let us say you are not receiving at the time, you are just setting the offset. But once you set the offset, you just break the loop, you just keep that value, whatever value you got, you store it there. So, after that you do not have to worry about this run length and so on, okay. So, digital stuff, the thing is, I mean, you can kind of memorize the value and then keep it. Why would you want to do this? Why did I want to increase the cutoff frequency? What is the reason? Basically, it will settle faster. I mean, if you have a very low cutoff frequency, it works with long run lengths, but when you start it, it also takes a long time to go and settle, okay. So, that is a problem. Which one? At the input? If we are looking at a DFE like scenario, no, because that cannot be, right, because then it cannot saturate. So, if we are looking at a DFE like scenario, essentially we are hoping to, this should have the ISI information. So, the DFE taps should subtract the ISI from this, and after that you have to make the decision. So, in that case, this is not a, I mean, this is not a full rail signal for sure, okay. Why? What is the relevance? So, yeah, it is not a, I mean, again, if we are looking at a challenging channel where we need a DFE, this whole thing has to be operating in a linear, like a linear amplifier, okay. Any other questions? So, just one more thing about amplifiers before we move on. So, this, like I said, because of this parasitic capacitors, this will have a limited bandwidth, okay. Now, one way to, and this is especially a problem when you at the point where you sum all the DFE taps, okay, because you have a number of these differential pairs coming together. So, that means that there will be a large parasitic capacitance here. Now, if you want to increase the bandwidth of a stage like this, what you could do is, you could use inductors. And again, there are analytical solutions, but there is a certain value of L you can choose for a given R and C, so that the bandwidth from here to there is maximized, okay, without peaking. That is, maybe the bandwidth of this, the magnitude response of this could look like that. Sorry, let me show it like that. With the proper choice of L, it is possible to do it like this, okay. So, you can improve the bandwidth. Now, the price you pay is the use of on-chip inductors, which are very large, okay. So, this is actually not a preferred solution. And certainly, if you have a 3-stage amplifier, if you put inductors in every stage, I mean, the manager will not be very happy. The one good thing is that these are not very high quality factor inductors, meaning they are already in series with resistors, right. So, you can use relatively lower quality inductors. But even then, maybe in some cases you have to use this, and this may be especially helpful for the DFE tap summation, where a number of things come together, the parasitics is very large, you have a really hard time meeting the bandwidth requirement, and you can use series inductors to fix that. Okay. Any questions about any of this? So, the circuits that are remaining are essentially related to making the decision, that is, in the receiver you have to have the decision latch, that one, and the flip flops. So, that those things we will look at in the next class and probably end it there. Any questions about anything that we discussed in the last few days, the transmitter circuits, other circuit level details? Okay, so we'll stop here.